21st day of the month of September, in an early year of a decade not too long before our own, the human race suddenly encountered a deadly threat to its very existence. Most innocent and unlikely of places.
Little shop of horror, little shop of terror, call the cops. Little shop of horror, no, oh, oh, no. Little shop of horror.
What'd you break now, Crowborn?
Nothing, Mr. Mushnick!
What a klutz. So she finally decides to come to work.
Good morning, Mr. Mushnick.
What morning? It's 2:00 in the afternoon. Not that we had a customer. Who has customers when you run a flower shop on Skid Row?
I'm sorry.
Seymour! What is going on back there?
Very little, Mr. Mushnick.
Audrey, you better go back there and see what he's... Audrey, where'd you get that shiner?
Shiner?
Audrey, that greasy boyfriend of yours been beating up on you again, huh? Look, I know it's none of my business, but if you ask me, he ain't a nice boy.
You don't meet nice boys when you live on Skid Row, Mr. Mushnick.
I got these plants repotted for you, Mr. Whoa!
Oh, look what you done to the inventory!
Don't yell at Seymour, Mr. Mushnick.
Audrey, you look radiant today. Is that new eye makeup?
I'll clean this up before any of the customers get here.
Well, that ought to give you plenty of time. God, what an existence I got. Misfit employees, bums on the sidewalk. Business is lousy. My life, it's a living hell.
God,
urchins! off the stoop. It ain't bad enough I got the winos permanently decorating the storefront. I gotta have four worthless ragamuffins to complete the picture.
Aw, we ain't bothering nobody, are we?
No, we're not, Ronette.
You ought to be in school.
We're on the split shift.
We went to school till fifth grade, then we split.
So how do you intend to better yourself?
Better ourselves? Mister, when you're in Skid Row, ain't no such thing.
Alarm goes off at 7, and you start uptown. You put in your 8 hours for the powers that have always been.
Sing it, Charles!
Till it's 5.
Look at that. 6 o'clock and we haven't sold so much as a fern. I guess this is it. Don't bother coming in tomorrow.
You don't mean...
You can't mean...
What? What don't I mean? I mean I'm closed. Forget it. Kaput.
Can't.
Kaput. Extinct. I'm closing this garden customer forsaken place.
Mr. Mushnik, forgive me for saying so, but has it ever occurred to you that maybe what the firm needs is to move in a new direction?
What Seymour's trying to say, Mr. Mushnik, is, well, we talked about it and we both agree. Seymour, why don't you bring in the back and bring one of those strange and interesting plants you've been working on? You see, Mr. Mushnik, some of those exotic plants Seymour's been tinkering around with are really unusual. And we're both thinking that some of these exotic plants, prominently displayed and advertised, would attract business.
I'm afraid it isn't feeling very well today.
Now, isn't that bizarre?
Well, at least, what kind of weirdo plant is this, Seymour?
I don't know. It looks like some kind of fly trap, but I haven't been able to identify it in any of my books. So, I gave it my own name. And Audrey, too.
After me?
I hope you don't mind. You see, sir, if you put a strange and interesting plant like this in the window, well, maybe...
Maybe what? Do you have any idea how ridiculous you sound? Just because you put a strange and interesting plant in a window, people don't suddenly...
Excuse me, I couldn't help noticing the strange and interesting plant in the window. What is it?
It's an archery too!
I've never seen anything like it before.
No one has.
Well, where did you get it?
Well... You remember that total eclipse of the sun a couple weeks ago?
Da-doo.
I was walking down the wholesale flower district that day.
Da-doo.
And I passed by this place where this old Chinese man, he sometimes sells me weird and exotic cuttings, you see. Cause he knows, cause straight plants are my hobby. Anyway, he didn't have any unusual plants there that day. So I was about to, you know, walk on by.
Good for you.
But then, suddenly, and without warning, there was this total eclipse of the sun. It got very dark. And then I heard a strange humming sound, like something from another world. And when the lights came back, there was this weird plant just sitting there. Just stuck in, you know, among the zinnias. No, I could have sworn, it had been there before. But the old Chinese man sold it to me anyway. $1.95.
Well, that's a very strange and interesting story. And while I'm here, I might as well take $50 worth of roses.
$50?
$50?
$50?
Yes, sir. Right away.
Can you break 100?
100? No. I'm afraid we closed the register for the day.
Oh. Well, I guess I'll just have to buy twice as many.
Twice as many?
Twice as many?
Twice as many?
Yes, sir. Audrey, darling, kindly fetch this gentleman $100 worth of our very finest red American beauty roses.
Thank you. And that's a very strange and unusual story.
Yeah! Quick, put the
An Archery 2!
Put that Archery 2 in the window where the passersby can see! My God, I never believed it! My children, I'm taking us out to dinner!
Oh, I can't deny. I got a date.
With the same no good Nick. I'm telling you, Audrey, you don't need a date with him. You need major medical.
He's a professional.
What kind of professional? Drives a motorcycle and wears a black leather jacket.
He's a rebel, Mr. Mushnik, and he makes good money. And besides, he's the only fella I got. Enjoy dinner. Good night, Seymour.
Good night.
Poor girl.
So, we still going for dinner?
You're not going anywhere, Crowbone. You're staying right here and taking care of this sick plant. Why's it fading all the time?
I told you. It's been giving me trouble for weeks. It just wilts like this. The RG2 is not a healthy girl.
Strictly between me and you, neither is the RG1.
Just wish I knew what breed it is. What genus. But I can't find it in any of my books.
Well, my advice to you, Crowbone, is you figure it out. And fast. Look what this exotic little beauty did for business.
I know.
So work, Seymour. Nurse that plant back to health. I'm counting on you.
I know.
You do?
I do.
So fix. Good night.
Oh, Tui. What I'm supposed to do with you? Mr. Mushnick and Audrey, well, they just met you, but me? I've been going through this with you for weeks. Grow and wilt. Spurt and flop. Are you a sickly little plant, or are you just plain stubborn? What is it you want? What is it you need? I've given you sunshine. I've given you dirt. You've given me nothing but heartache and hurt. I'm begging you sweetly. I'm down on my knees. Oh, please grow for me. I've given you plant food and water to sip. I've given you potash. You've given me zip. Oh God, how I missed you. Oh pot, how you tease. Now please grow for me. I've given you southern exposure to get you to thrive. I beat you back hard like I'm supposed to. You're barely alive. I tried you with levels of moisture from desert to mud. I've given you grow lights and mineral supplements. What do you want from me, blood? Damn thorns. Damn roses. Hey, Tui, look what I did. What made you do that? As long as you don't make a habit of it or anything. I've given you sunlight. I've given you rain. Looks like you're not happy unless I open a vein. I'll give you a few drops if that'll appease. Now please, oh please, well, grow for me.
Thank you.
address! The address! Mention the... Oh, well. Still great advertising. I can't believe it. It couldn't be happening. Pinch me, girls. It couldn't be happening. All of this sudden success coming out of the blue. I put a sign up right in the front window. An advertisement right in the front window. Come in and see the amazing new plan, Audrey 2. And the really remarkable thing is that people, they do see more that twerp of a klutz. Funny, did something right, Audrey 2 drives them nuts. What a blessing, this wonderful plan should exist. And you're breaking the bucks for me, hand over fist.
Oh, you was great, Seymour.
You sounded sexier than a wolf man.
But you didn't mention the address of the shop. How many times have I told you?
I'm sorry, I was nervous. Where's Audrey? She said she'd be here.
Forget about Audrey. I got 3 more radio interviews lined up for tomorrow, and this Skid Row Howard examiner wants a picture.
God, mother, she'd be so happy.
You're an overnight sensation, Seymour. Who would have believed it? One day he pushed a broom, nothing in his news but doom and gloom. Then he lit a fuse and different broom. Stand aside and watch that mother blow. Explosion, bang, kaboom. Don't it go to show you never know.
Seymour was in a funk. He was number 0. Who'd have thunk? He's become a hero.
All the world used to screw him. They fire pow, now they interview him. And they clamor to put his remarks on the air. All the world used to hate him. Now they started to appreciate him. And all because of that strange little plan over there.
Cut my hand and in a snap, what? Something out of Edgar Allan Poe has happened.
Zam kazap, don't it go to show you never know.
I wanted to be here to cheer him on, but...
Don't tell me
you got tied up.
No, just handcuffed a little.
Girl, I don't know who it is you're hanging out with, but he is hazardous to your health.
He sure is, but I can't leave him.
Why not?
He'd get angry. And if he does this to me when he likes me, imagine what he'd do if he ever got mad.
So dump the chump, get another guy, and get him to protect you.
And we got one all picked out.
A little botanical genius!
And she ain't talking about George Washington Carver.
Seymour?
Bingo!
Oh, we're just friends. I could never be Seymour's girl. I've got a past.
And who amongst us has not?
I don't even deserve a sweet, considerate... suddenly successful guy like Seymour.
This girl suffers from low self-esteem.
You have a point.
She have a problem.
I know Seymour's the greatest, but I'm dating a semi-sadist. So I've got a black eye and my arms in a cast. Seymour's a cutie. Well, if not, he's got inner beauty. And I dream of a place where we could be together ever.
Come and place that, honey. An emergency room?
Oh, no. It's just a daydream of mine. A little development I dream of, just off the interstate. Not fancy like Leopard Town. Just a little street in a little suburb, far, far from urban Skid Row. The sweetest, greenest place where everyone has the same little lawn out front and the same little flagstone patio out back. And all the houses are so neat and pretty, cause they all look just alike. Aw, I dream about it all the time. Just me, and a toaster, and a sweet little guy, like Seymour. A matchbox of our own. A fence of real chain link. A grill out on the patio. Disposal in the sink. A washer and a dryer and an ironing machine. In a tract house that we share, somewhere that's green. He rakes and trims the grass. He loves to mow and weed. I cook like Betty Crocker. Pine soul scented air, somewhere that's green. Between our frozen dinners and our bedtime 9:15, we snuggle watching Lucy on our big, enormous 12-inch screen. I'm his December bride. He's father, he knows best. Our kids watch Howdy Doody as the sun sets in the west. A picture out of better homes and gardens.
Up and booming, cause customers are flocking and business has been booming. We need refrigeration in our new improved display, so we're closed for renovation today.
Yes indeed, this is the shop you heard about on Channel 5 News. Yes, the object is on display exclusively here.
the clothes for decoration, cause fortune has been smiling. So now we're due for painting, new pumping and retiling. We'll make your ship shape show place of our little shop, and then tomorrow we'll be open again.
Aren't you finished yet?
I'm doing my best, but all these band-aids are making it kind of hard.
Oh, you've been getting hurt so much lately.
I know. Seems like every time I pick up pruning shears, I slip.
We're closed for renovation, we're swabbing down and brooming, cause business has been thriving since our tissue's been blooming. The phones have now stopped ringing with the customers inside.
Another bunch of peonies,
another dozen daisies please,
geraniums and anemones,
forget-me-nots and fleur-de-lis,
with Friday song deliveries,
paying fools and CODs.
We're closed for renovation.
Hey, Seymour.
Did you send that order out for Mrs. Shiva?
Mrs. Shiva.
Mrs. Shiva!
I forgot.
You forgot? How could you forget an order like that? The Shivas are our most important funeral account. A big, enormous family, and they're dropping off like flies. Seymour, if we lose that business over this, you are finished!
You know, sometimes I think that Mr. Mushnick is too hard on you.
Oh, I don't mind. After all, I owe him everything. He took me out of Skid Row home for boys when I was just a tyke. Gave me a warm place to sleep under the counter. Nice things to eat, like meatloaf and water. Floors to sweep and toilets to clean and every other Sunday off.
You know, I think you ought to raise your expectations, Seymour. Now that you're getting successful, I mean, why don't you start with some new clothes? No offense, but with all those photo sessions and interviews, a big, important botanist has to look the part.
I'm a very bad shopper, Audrey. I don't have good taste like you.
Well, maybe I could help you pick things out.
You could?
Sure.
You go shopping with me?
Sure.
You'd be seen with me in a public place like a department store?
Sure.
Tonight?
Oh, I can't tonight. I've got a date, but I'd like to go with you some other time.
Sure, I'll pencil you in.
I bet you got a lot of dates now, huh?
Not dates exactly, but a lot of gardening clubs have been calling up, asking me to give lectures. Imagine me giving lectures.
Oh, that doesn't matter. You have life experience.
Oh, some experience. I don't even know what it's like to fly an airplane.
Me neither.
Or have fancy dinner at Howard Johnson's.
Me neither.
Or ride a motorcycle.
Oh, it's no big deal. And besides, it's dangerous.
It is?
Very. Gee, I better go fix my face. My date will be here any minute.
Excuse me, ladies. Which way's 13 Skid Row?
I'm afraid that information will cost you a dollar. It's right over there. But if you're like the thousands of others flocking to see the Audrey 2, you better come back tomorrow, man. The shop is closed today. Took his dollar!
I'm not here to buy posies, girls. I'm here to pick up my date.
Your date? You ain't buying a chance talking about that girl with the black eye?
And several other medical problems?
Well, as a matter of fact... Ladies! My kind is a very nice kind. I'm not a monster.
What else would you call it then?
I would call it occupational hazard.
Say what?
You'll see, girls, my line of work requires a certain fascination with human pain and suffering. Allow me to demonstrate. When I was younger, just a bad little kid, my mama noticed funny things I did. Last unit puppies with a BB gun. I poisoned guppies, and when I was done, I find a pussycat and bash in his head. That's when my mama said,
what did she say?
She said, my boy, I think someday you'll find a way to make your natural intentions pay. Son, be a dentist.
You'll be a dentist.
You'll have a talent for causing pain. Son, be a dentist.
Son, be a dentist.
People will fail to be inhumane.
Inhumane.
Your temperament's wrong for the priesthood, and teaching will suit you still less. Son, be a dentist.
You'll be a success.
Serious girls, the leader of the pack.
Watch him suck up that gas. Oh my God. He's a dentist and he'll never ever be any good.
Who wants their teeth done by the Marquis de Sade? Oh, that hurts.
I'll shut up, open wide, here I come! I am your dentist, and I enjoy the career that I take. I am your dentist, and I get off on the pain I inflict.
You really love it.
When I start extracting those molars, girls will be screaming like, oh, though it may cause my patients distress. And somewhere in heaven above me, I know that my mom is proud of me. Cause I'm a dentist and a success. Say ah!
Ah!
Say ah! Now spit! Hey, how you doing?
Fine, thank you, but the shop's closed.
I'm not here to shop, I'm here to... Hey, isn't that the plan they're talking about on the news? What do you call it?
An orgy too?
Ah, cute name. Catchy. Nice plant. Big.
Well, thanks. I raised it myself, but if you don't mind, you can't be in here. I'm so sorry.
I heard it's some new kind of species or something.
Well, that's what they tell me. But look, I'm sorry, you're gonna have to go. I can't have anyone in here now.
It's okay. This is my boyfriend, Aaron Scrivello, DDS.
I say, guy, you raised that thing, right?
Right.
Well, I sure as hell wouldn't keep it in a barrel down Skid Row like this. This avocado could be your ticket to the stars. You'll take that to any florist shop. Name your price. Hell, some would even make you their goddamn partner to get their hands on that thing.
I don't care. I'm happy here.
Seymour's very loyal.
Somebody talking to you?
Oh, no. Excuse me.
Excuse me what?
Excuse me, doctor.
Much better. I'm telling you, kid, this thing is a big green gold mine. So get your ass out of this dump and take the plan with you. Mushnik Skid Row Florist. It's a joke, you hear me talking?
Well, I hear you.
He hears him.
Shouldn't we be leaving now?
Somebody talking to you!
I'm sorry, doctor. Sorry, doctor.
You got China messed up. Mm-hmm. Well, my bike's outside double parked, but you think about what I said.
Sure, I'll think about it.
You think about it?
You do that. Okay, Audrey? Got the handcuffs.
They're out of my bag.
Then let's go.
You think about it. You think about it.
I don't like that guy, Mr. Mushnick. And you should see the way he talks to Audrey.
God in Himmel know the kid just said he'd mull it over.
No wonder she's so unhealthy. It's enough to make you sick.
If he left me, if Seymour left me, well then I'd be right back where I started, which was broken, starving.
Sweet and good and beautiful as she is, she deserves a prince, not a sadistic creep like him.
Close the bankrupt.
What a louse.
Just be set, befuddled and bereft. That's what I'd be if Seymour left.
He's a disgrace to the dental profession.
Seymour!
Sir!
Seymour! How would you like to be my son? How would you like to be my own adopted boy? I never liked him much before, but come the cash is in the drawer. I've got no choice, I must do boy say yes.
What for?
Seymour, I want to be your dad. I wanna see you climbing up my family tree. I used to think you left the stench, but now I see the tremendous swamp. Propose to be my son. Mushnick and son. Sound great. About as you want to be my son. Just say the word, I'll have my lawyer on the phone.
Now, Mr. Mushnick, don't be rash. You always said that I was trash.
Oh, I was joking.
Sir, I'm joking.
Excuse the physical expression of my pride, of the sweet paternal mysticus I've held pent up inside.
Gee.
So?
Well, I.
You? Go ahead and say it, Seymour. Tell me that you will.
Gee, I'd really like to, but.
I'll hold my breath until.
Yeah. Okay, you widowed be your son!
Hooray, I will be my son!
Tore up the papers, Dad, I'm touched, I really am. And when you reach age 83, I'll let you come move in with me!
You swear?
I promise!
What a son!
Sickness and in health, we'll share the plan, we'll share the wealth.
I'll call my lawyer.
Call me son.
Son.
Mushnick and son. That's. Officially, I'm your brat. Consider the matter closed and done. Now to the world, let's stick. And slick way, so come kiss me quick.
Please don't make me sick.
Mushnick and son. Sorry. changes surround me. Lady Luck came and found me. Thanks a million for making the magic you do. Thanks to you, sweet Petunia. Mushnik's taken a junior. Someday when I own this whole shop, I'll remember I owe it to you. Oh, Tui. So what if I've been on all the anemic side these past few weeks? So what if I've had a couple dizzy spells? A little lightheadedness? Been worth it all, pal. Anyway, I'm a little hungry, so I'm gonna head down to Smendris to get a bite to eat. I'll see you in the morning. Oh boy. Look, I haven't got much left. Just give me a couple more days to heal, okay? Then we'll start again from the left hand.
Feed me!
I beg your pardon?
Feed me!
Tui, you talked. You opened your trap, your thing, and you said...
Feed me, Crowborn. Feed me now!
But I can't.
I'm starving!
I know, but you can't get blood from it.
More!
I haven't got it anymore. What do you want me to do? Slip my wrists?
Ooh.
Look. How about I head down to the corner and get some nice chopped sirloin?
Must be blood.
Tui, that's disgusting.
Must be fresh.
I don't want to hear this.
Feed me!
Does it have to be human?
Feed me!
Does it have to be mine?
Feed.
Where am I supposed to get it?
Feed me, Seaboy. Feed me all night long. That's right, boy. You can do it. Feed me, Seaboy. Feed me all night long. Yeah, cause if you feed me, Seymour, I can go up big and strong.
Look, you eat blood, Audrey. Let's face it, how am I supposed to keep on feeding you? Kill people?
I'll make it worth your while.
What?
You think this is all a coincidence, baby? The sudden success around here? Your adoption papers?
Look! You're a plant! An inanimate object!
Does this look inanimate to you, punk? If I can talk and I can move, who's to say I can't do anything I want?
Like what?
Like deliver, pal! Like see you get everything your secret greasy heart desires. How's about a guy like Carr? Or it gets shot all jackpot? How about a date with Elma? You gon' get it. How'd you like to be a big wheel? Dining out for every meal. I'm the plant that can make it all real. And you'll get it.
You know how to get it.
I'm your genie, I'm your friend. I'm your willing slave. Take a chance with feeding me in. You're the kind of eat, the kind of red hot treat. Got a sneaky, sneaky tea time. Come on, see me, don't be a butt. Put me in your lap, and surely that would kick dust. Show a little bit.
I don't know, I know, I am so, so many strong reservations. Should I go and perform mutilations?
Didn't have nothing till you met me. Aw, come on, kid. What'll it be? Money? Girls? One particular girl? How about that Audrey? Think it over. There must be someone you can 86 real quiet like and get me some lunch. How's about a room of turrets? Wrapped in film and covered in bits. A little bit of the ambulance. You get it.
Harley Mercy,
okay.
Swing around like I was
yeah.
Making all the guys in the cut of the tree.
So don't get it. If you wanna be profound, then you really ought to justify. Take a breath and look around. A lot of folks deserve to die.
Wait a minute! That's not a very nice thing to say.
Oh, but it's true, isn't it?
No! I don't know anyone who deserves to be chopped up and fed to a hungry plant!
Sure you do.
Stupid woman! Christ, what a friggin' scatterbrain!
I'm sorry, Doctor! I'm sorry, Doctor!
Now get in there and pick up your goddamn sweater, you dizzy cow!
Yes, Doctor! Right away, Doctor! Hi, Seymour! I left my sweater here before!
Come on, move me, you little slut! How do you like the goddamn dame? Forget the friggin' sweater! Christ, if your head was screwed up!
Arin! That hurts!
Move it!
If you are harassed now, here's the very honesty. Stop and think it all about.
The guy sure looks like plant food to me.
The guy sure looks like plant food to me. The guy sure looks like plant food to me.
He's so nasty, treating a rock.
Jacking around and now he's talking so dumb.
You need blood, he's gonna bottle it up.
I need blood, he's gonna put it in dust. You need blood, he's gonna bottle it up.
That's me, Dr. Scrivello.
You have an appointment?
Seymour Krellborn, we met yesterday.
The guy with the plants!
Right.
And the band-aids!
Right.
And a gun!
Right.
Why are you pointing a gun at me, Seymour?
Are
you a little bit nervous about seeing the dentist?
No, I'm not nervous.
It's only gonna hurt a little!
I don't think you understand. I don't want my teeth examined.
Of course you want your teeth examined. Now say ah!
No!
Say ah!
Ah!
Your mouth's a mess. You got cavities, you got plaque, you're impact. You're obsessed.
I am.
You need a complete oral examination. We'll start with a wisdom tooth.
No!
We'll just rip the little bugger out of there. What do you say?
I gotta go.
There's always time for dental hygiene, Seymour. Have you ever seen the results of a neglected mouth? Look, Seymour, this could happen to you.
It could.
Unless we take immediate action. So let's get started.
Wait! Aren't you gonna give me any Novocaine?
For what, dull the senses?
But it'll hurt!
Only until you pass out.
What's that?
This is a drill, Seymour.
It's rusty.
It's an antique. They don't make instruments like these anymore. Sturdy, heavy, dull. This is gonna be a challenge. This is gonna be a pleasure. I'm gonna want some gas for this one.
Gas?
Nitrous oxide.
Oh, thank God. I thought you weren't gonna give me any.
The gas isn't for you, Seymour, it's for me! You see, a little bit of giggle gas right before I get started increases my pleasure enormously. In fact, I'm gonna wear my special gas mask for this one. You wait, Seymour. I'll be with you in a moment.
Now, do it now, while he's gassing himself to a palpable stupor. The timing's ideal and the moment is super. To ready and fire and blow the sick bastard away. Now, do it now, just a flick or a presser right here on the trigger, and Audrey won't have to put up with that pig for another day. Now for the girl, now for the plant, now yes I will, but I can't.
Oh, Seymour, I'm flying now. The things we're gonna do to your mouth. Well, I guess I've had about enough of this stuff. I'll just take the mask off now.
Seymour! Guess what?
What?
It's stuck!
What?
I can't get it off! Jesus Christ, I could asphyxiate in this thing. Oh, Seymour, come give me a hand, will ya?
Well.
Well? He says, well? Seymour, I don't think you really understand. Don't be fooled if I should chuckle like a happy sappy dope. It's just the gas. It's got me high. But don't let that fact deceive you. In a moment I could die. Though I giggle like a wardle, bear in mind I'm not immortal. Oh, this whole thing strikes me funny, I don't know. It really is my way to go.
What we have here is an ethical dilemma. Let's help him get the mass. Ruby doesn't have a prayer. Drew the gun was never fired, but the way of revenge was fired. I can finish him with simple as a fair. What we have here is a tricky moral problem. Let's help him get the mass. Ruby doesn't have a prayer. Drew the gun was never fired, but the way of revenge was fired. I can finish him with simple as a fair.
Don't be fooled. If I should chuckle like hyenas in the zoo, it's just the gas. Oh, it turns me on. But don't let that make the scene. In a moment I'll be gone. Cause all my virtual signs are failing. Cause the outside I'm inhaling makes it difficult as hell to catch my breath. Are you dumb? Or hard of hearing? Or really? My end is nearing. Are you satisfied? I've laughed myself to
death.
hotels are our speciality. Camellias, magnolias, hepaticas, and gorgeous gladiolus.
Urchins, look, here's 10 apiece. Deliver these to the Dutch pavilion, and these to the Japanese consul.
Step right up and see the amazing gorgeous
soup. I've seen it.
Not unless you've seen it recently, you haven't. It's got amazing multicolored quartz.
Quartz.
And it's amazing.
Then let's go. Audrey, I'm late for the lawyers. Make sure Seaman delivers Coleman his wolfbane.
Yes, ma'am. Nitrophenium, geranium, wisteria, wisteria, japonica. You name it, we sell it.
There it is.
Remarkable.
Mr. Mushnick, I got those batteries delivered to a Taylor Suite. She's real pretty.
You said it was the flowers.
Sure, I'll take three of those, two of those, one of those, seven of those, and three of those.
I'll hear for you, sir. Thank you now. Come again now. Goodbye.
Mushnick-san, Skid Row's for the florist. Mushnick-san, can you hold? Seymour, can you help me with these phones?
Mushnick-san, Skid Row's favorite florist. Can you hold, please?
Skid Row's favorite florist, can you hold? Now you're saying... Flowers for a prom cassage.
Flowers for an entourage.
Flowers to the funeral home.
Leaving from St. Andrew's Roman Catholic Church in 9th and 5.
$40 hold the line.
First thing in the morning,
fine.
They'll be there in the morning.
Can you hold the rose bar? Seymour, the rose bar.
And son, please hold.
Can you hold?
It's just as the plan foretold.
Just a minute.
It's business like you'd have ever guessed.
Mushnick and son,
that was me.
Please hold.
That was me.
The business
on channel 3.
So why am I feeling so depressed?
I get 2 tickets to the game. Mushnick and son, Skid Row's favorite florist.
7,000 boudonnieres, carnations, or the yellow roses.
Please, I've only got 2 ears. Allergic to 2 chrysanthemums.
Hollyhocks, a hardia. Which one would your wife prefer?
Were you waiting long? I'm sorry, sir. 1 minute, and I'll get her for you.
Seymour, that reporter.
Her, I thought we finished yesterday.
She wants another interview. Said to bring the plan with you.
Audrey, that's a new account.
Sorry, that's the right amount.
Daisy's only come in white.
Sir, I'm too worn out to fight.
Sorry, those are out of stock.
Seymour, look, it's 6 o'clock.
Call back in the morning, will you?
Call back in the morning, won't you?
Call back in the morning, can you?
Call back in the morning, thank you.
Call back in the morning.
What a day. What a day. Seymour, do you mind locking off for me? I'm all in.
Oh, 1 minute, Audrey. I want to show you something.
Can't it wait till tomorrow?
It won't take a minute. So, I went shopping for some new clothes like you told me to, and, ta-da!
Seymour.
You don't like it?
I don't know.
I'll take it off. I'll take it back. I'll burn it. Audrey! Audrey, please don't cry, please! Look what I did. I only bought it to impress you. That's all I ever meant to do.
I don't know what's come over me. I guess I've been a bit under the weather lately.
It's Oren, isn't it? You've been down in the dumps ever since this mysterious disappearance. You miss him, don't you?
Miss him? I've never been so relieved as when they told me he'd vanished. Never mind all the money I've saved on Epsom salts and ace bandages.
And what's the matter?
I feel guilty, I guess. I mean, if he met with some foul play or some terrible accident of some kind. It's my fault, you see, because secretly, I wished it.
Audrey, you shouldn't waste 1 more minute worrying about that creep. There's a lot of guys out there who'd give anything to go out with you. Nice guys.
I don't deserve a nice guy. nice guy, Seymour.
But that's not true.
You don't know the half of it. I've led a terrible life.
Audrey, don't.
I deserved a creep like Orange Scrivello, DDS. You know where I met him? In the gutter.
Gutter?
The gutter. It's a night spot. I worked there on my nights off when we weren't making much money. I put on cheap and tasteless outfits. Not nice ones like these. Low and nasty apparel, and I...
Audrey, that's all behind you now. You've got nothing to be ashamed of. You're a very nice person, and I always knew you were. Under all the bruises and the handcuffs, you know what I saw? Girl I respected, and I still do. Lift up your head, wash off your mascara. Here, take my Kleenex, wipe that lipstick away. Show me your face, as clean as a morning. I know things were bad, but now they're okay. Suddenly Seymour is standing beside you. Don't need no makeup, don't have to pretend. Suddenly Seymour is here to provide you with sweet understanding. Seymour's your friend.
Nobody ever treated me kindly. Daddy left early, Mama was poor. I'd be a man and I'd follow him blindly. He'd snap his fingers, me I'd say sure.
Washed away.
Please understand that it's still strange and frightening. Losing like I've been, it's so hard to say.
Thickens among my employees.
Please, Mr. Daddy.
Don't you miss the daddy meat, Crowborn. Audrey, would you excuse Seymour and I for a while? Perhaps go visit your dentist friend?
That's not very funny, Dad. You know he disappeared.
Oh, that's right. He did, didn't he? Forgive me, boy chick.
Seymour? What's he talking about? What's he doing?
Why don't you run along like he asked, Audrey? I'll catch up with you later. I'll call for you if that's okay.
course it is. Good night, Seymour. Good night, Mr. Mushnick.
Little red dots. All over the floor.
You're acting pretty strange, Pop.
I had a pretty strange afternoon, son. After my lawyer's appointment, I was called to the police station.
The police?
Yeah. Seems they did a routine investigation into the disappearance of this motorcycle dentist. And they found a Mushnick Skid Row florist bag in his office.
What's that supposed to mean?
Exactly what I asked myself, Seymour. Then I began to think about certain things I noticed around here. Little red dots all over the linoleum.
I spilled some Hawaiian punch and it's stained.
Hard to keep things clean around here, isn't it? Especially when they only remove our garbage once a month.
What's that got to do with... Where are you going?
We want something removed in a hurry. Best not to dispose of it on Skid Row.
What are you talking about?
This. A dentist suit.
He's got your number now.
I saw it last week and I didn't think twice.
He knows just what you've done.
And little red dots seemed innocent enough.
You've got no place to hide.
But then I catch you with the dentist's girlfriend.
You've got nowhere to run.
And it begins to look like a motive.
He knows your life of crime.
Once he's out of the way, you move in, right?
I think it's up a time.
No, I'm innocent. I'm innocent.
Then how do you explain this?
I picked her for a baseball cap.
Your baseball cap. The police found it in Scarello's office. Showed it to me, and that's the bike it identified.
Well, did you?
No. They don't suspect you at all, Seymour. They didn't know about the dots, the uniform, the girlfriend.
I didn't do it.
Then come with me to the police station and tell them that.
He's got his facts all straight.
Just so my conscience will rest easy.
You know he's on your track.
If you don't do it, I have to go myself.
He's gonna turn you in.
Now will you come?
They're gonna put you in jail.
Okay.
He's USD.
I'll go lock up. We'll head over.
For my sabotage.
Wait! Don't you want to collect your day's receipts so you can deposit them in the morning?
You put them in the safe, didn't you?
No.
Well, why not?
Well, I forgot the combination.
It's $1,000. Where is it?
In the plant.
In the plant?
Well, I thought it'd be the safest place, you know. No thief is ever gonna look in there, right?
You put the money in the plant. How am I supposed to get it?
Just knock.
Knock. Seymour!
That's him.
That's him, Mr. Bernstein.
Timo, Krelborn, Sweetie, Honey, Baby, Pussycat.
Do I know you?
Of course not. But you're going to be happy when you do. Seymour, Sweetheart, Babyface, Bobolev.
Timo, Krelborn, I present to you.
My name is Burns John, and with NBC, I've come down here to present to you a weekly TV show for me. Seymour Krelborn's gardening tips for half an hour on Sundays at 4. TV's first home gardening program. You'll make him into our ratings will soar.
They take a big shell and tear it. You know the book doesn't lie. It's not a question of merit.
Coming to
him by and by.
You're on TV show.
Coast to coast.
Your name in loud.
Your face on screen.
Sign it.
Sign it.
Sign that contract.
Isn't it exciting?
Here he is, Mrs. Luce. I found him. There's Seymour.
Please, girls, I don't want to see anybody else today.
My darling, my precious, my sweet, sweet thing. I'm so delighted to make your acquaintance.
I'd like a word with you, lover. I'm sure you know me, the editor's wife. We want your face on the cover of the December 3rd issue of Life.
We've been trying to reach you, baby. Have your phone been busy? Did you get our telegram?
I don't think so.
Well, it's a good thing I came down in person then. Pleased to meet you, kid. Skip, snip, William Morrison. Get the cable we sent you. It's nice to meet me. The pleasure is yours. Now let my firm represent you. We want to book you on lecturing tours. College campus Rotary Club. The bookings my office can do. Show the plant, then talk, answer questions. It's educational, lucrative too.
My future's starting. I've got to let it stick with the plan and see my bank account will thrive. What am I saying? No way, forget it. It's much too dangerous to keep the plan alive. I take these offers, that means more healing. Who knew success would come with messy, nasty strings? I sign these contracts, that means I'm willing to keep on doing bloody awful evil things. No, no. The vegetable must be destroyed.
But then there's Audrey, lovely Audrey. If life were tawdry and impoverished as before, she might not like me, she might not want me. Without my plans, she might not love me anymore.
They say the meek shall inherit.
Where do I sign?
You know the good doesn't lie.
Right on the line.
It's not a question of merit.
That'll do fine.
It's not the man is blind.
This cup is mine. Can't you see I'm busy?
Aw, tough titty!
What's your language?
Grub!
I can't take much more of this. Look, I gotta finish my speech for the lecture tour. It's all about you. Just give me some peace and quiet or I'll tell them the truth.
Aw, don't get cute with me. I made you, and I can break you.
Oh, go ahead. Break me. Do you think it's easy living with this girl?
Aw, cut the crap and bring on the meat!
Oh, if only it'd eat me. If only a touch of mouse or some flies. But no! You're so particular!
Come on, Crowbone, feed me. I ain't ate since Mushnik. And that was a week ago!
Look, hold off one more night. Life magazine are coming in the morning to take our picture.
And then you'll find me somebody?
And you'll never be hungry again. I promise.
Shout out, Grillborn! Food! Food!
I can't take much more of this!
Feed me,
Seymour!
Feed me!
You're driving me crazy!
Come on,
shut up, you forgot it! Shut up! Shut up! Shut up! Shut up!
Seymour! What's the matter with you?
It's the matter with me! Don't you think I know it needs food? Don't you think I know it'll die if I don't feed it, and soon? Don't you think I'm trying to think of something, some way, or someone?
Seymour! You're hysterical! What's the big deal about a little plant food? You know, I think running this shop all by yourself is too much for you. When did Mr. Mushnik say you'd be back?
Huh?
You know, in that letter you told me he wrote you about going to see his sister in...
Czechoslovakia. Right. He could be gone a very long time, Audrey. Audrey, can I ask you something?
Anything?
Well, suppose for a minute that there had never been an Audrey too. And I was just a nothing again, a nobody. Would you still like me?
I'd still love you, Seymour.
And that settles it.
What settles? A gun?
And bullets, and rat poison, and a machete. Tomorrow morning, right after Life magazine's taking our picture, you know who bites the dust?
Seymour.
Right. They'll snap the photo, we'll be famous, I'll take the TV job, and we'll live a nice, quiet, normal life together. No more night feedings, no more squalling for blood.
What feedings? What blood? I don't get it, Seymour. You're scaring me.
Oh, no. There's nothing to be scared of. I'll take you to that, little development you always dreamed about. And once we're there, we'll live happily ever after, I promise. Nice little house, nice little car, and no plants. No plants at all.
You're talking so peculiar, Seymour.
I'll explain everything in the morning. Just go home now, Audrey, please.
I can't leave you in this condition.
Don't worry about me. Don't worry about anything. Feed me. Under no circumstances.
Feed me.
I will not, so stop asking.
Feed me!
I can't take much more of this. Look, how about I head down to the corner and get some nice, rare roast beef? Will that be enough to hold you off till Life magazine get here?
No way.
Well, that's my final offer, so yes or no?
It's better than nothing.
Done. Fine. Great. Don't think you're getting a dessert!
I couldn't sleep. I took a Somanex. But voices in my head kept saying, go to Seymour, talk to Seymour. I drank some tea, but gee, the feeling wasn't gone. Seymour, sweetheart, tell me, darling, what's been going on?
Lady, hello.
Who said that?
You're looking cute as can be.
There's somebody in there!
You're looking mighty sweet!
Seymour!
No, it ain't Seymour. It's me!
Oh my God!
Your friendly Audrey too! This plant is talking to you.
I don't believe this!
Believe it, baby, it talks.
Am I dreaming this?
No, and you ain't in Kansas neither. Relax and go with it, doll. Do me a favor, will you, sweetheart?
A favor?
I need me some water in the worst way. Look at my branch. I'm a goner, honey. Come on and give me a drink.
I don't know if I should.
Hey, little lady, be nice.
Audrey, are you all right?
Yes. No.
Don't die, Audrey. Please don't die. I need you.
You know, the plant said the strangest thing just now. He said that Orin and Mr. Mushnick were already inside.
It's true. I did it. I fed them to it.
That's what made it so big and strong, and you so famous.
I've done terrible things, Audrey. But not to you. Never to you.
I want you to see more.
What?
When I die, which will be very shortly, feed me to the plant so it can live and bring you all the wonderful things you deserve.
You don't know what you're saying.
But I do. It's the one gift I can give you. And if I'm in the plant, then I'm part of the plant. So in a way, we'll always be together. You wash my tender leaves. You'll smell my sweet perfume. You'll water me and care for me. You'll see me bud and bloom.
Contented and serene. That's him, Mr. Martin. He's right there.
Thanks, sweetheart. Wait for me. Krelborn. Seymour? Krelborn?
Leave me alone.
Patrick Martin, Licensing and Marketing Division, World Botanical Enterprises. I've got a gilt-edged proposition for you, boy.
I'm not interested.
Let me explain in more detail. It's a very simple licensing deal. We take leaf cuttings, developable RG2s, and send them to florists across the nation. Pretty soon, every hospital in America will have one. I've got a truck waiting outside in some parts. If you don't mind, we'll start taking cuttings right now. Imagine, boy, RG2s everywhere. Why, with the right advertising, this could be bigger than hula hoops.
Bigger than hula hoops?
Much bigger!
Every household in America, thousands of you eating. That's what's been on your mind all along, isn't it?
No shit, Sherlock!
We're not talking about one hungry plant here. We're talking about world conquest!
And I wanna thank you!
You're a monster, so am I!
Feed me!
You ain't the only thing I ever loved.
Aw, too bad!
Take that! And there!
Give up, Krelborn!
Never! Rap pointing! Here! Eat it!
Give up, small fry!
You may be strong enough on the outside, but in there, in that pod, I'll hack you to bits! I'll get you from the inside! Open up! Open up! Open up! No!
Open the van, boys. We're ready to start loading.
Proceeding.
you on, girls. Shall we wait until the rest? It is right balance, isn't it? Good evening, Planet Earth, Haverhill, UK, and the globe. First of all, thank you for everybody for tuning in this evening and watching our final performance of Little Shop of Horrors. Obviously, these things take a lot of time and a lot of effort from multiple people, not just the people you can see around us. So I want to take this opportunity just to thank lots of people. I've got a big list, but I'll try and rattle through it as quick as I possibly can, because I can be quite boring sometimes. So first of all, I want to say a massive thank you for Anthony Davis and his team at SWD Scaffold, and he provided this scaffold, a skeleton for us back in, I think it was January. And they kindly said we can look after it until the show is finished. So my thanks, Anthony, goes out to you. So thank you so much. Also, Terry and Ian Gotcher and Doug Danes from Accord Stageworks, who loaned us this these wonderful props, the Audrey 2s and so forth. We had originally obviously booked this for March, and they said, that's absolutely fine. You take your time. As soon as you're ready, give us a call. And here they are. And they've been absolutely wonderful. So thank you, Terry, Ian, and Doug, for coming down to do that with us. The site team, Tony Davis and Robin Danes, who have just given me permission to have the key to lock up. I don't know why they trust me for it. I don't even trust myself, but they've been really, really lovely to allow me, us and the team, to stay here quite late and lock up. And also, I was told that, what's his face? Alan came up to me, Alan the Cat. We love Alan, don't we? Alan! Yes. I love Alan. Alan came up to me and he goes, I'm not on the credits. Put me on there now, please, because Alan picked up the kettle drums from Linton College, and he spent a good half an hour doing that. So, Alan, thank you very much to you, and I've put you on the list. Also, thank you to Ben Prickett from the Arts Centre for being so supportive and offering a lot of your support and your guidance and tech knowledge on helping us set up for the evening. Backstage, Angie Lane can't be with us today. I think she's isolating, but Angelaine and Chloe Guinevan, who have been absolutely wonderful backstage. The plant pods and also backstage was operated by, are they here now? Oh, you can't see them, but Maddie Winchester was operating Audrey 3 and Audrey 4, and a massive job, and she was supported by Annabelle, Larry Westwood, Emily Regan, Ryan Murphy, and they've been absolutely wonderful. Give them a round of applause, please. They've been brilliant. A massive round of applause to Shannon Chandler, Monsieur Le Maire, Lucy Winchester, and Tony Johnson, who have been our camera people. They've been absolutely amazing. Not you, David. You can shut up for a second. Not you. Give yourself a wave. That's Lucy over there. She's very shy, but she's lovely. And yes, I think I mentioned those guys. So a massive round of applause for the those guys there, please. Need to say a huge shout out to, he hates it when I call him this, but he says, just call me John, Matthew. But so massive thanks to Monsieur Le Maire of Haverhill, who's just been brilliant. He's provided us of all of the, there he is, there you are, look, give a little wave, sir, give a little wave. He's so shy, look, there he is, yay. The mayor has lent us all of these cameras and has been here every night during the tech and the setup. He's just been absolutely wonderful. We're very, very pleased to have your support, sir. So, Monsieur Le Maire, thank you very much. Lovely. And the visuals, here we go. Now it's your turn, Mr. Johnson. Dave Johnson over there. He's been in charge. There he is. Oh, he's so pretty, look. Isn't he lovely? Dave Johnson has been responsible for mixing all the visuals, and he's been here again every single day, every single tech rehearsal. He's absolutely wonderful, so thank you so much. And also, Steve Marsh from the Arts Centre. There he is, Steve Marsh. They call him Ginger Steve. I can't understand why, but... that's Steve from the Arts Centre. Again, he's been here all the weekend tech, so thank you very much, Steve. Give these guys a round of applause, please. That's lovely. Getting towards the end now. Also, I want to say a massive thank you to Gareth and Luke Hammond. They're also very, very shy. If you can get the camera up there, Monsieur Le Maire. But they are all lighting people. They're very, very shy. But Luke and Gareth, they're probably waving. You can't see them, can you? Give us a shout out, boys. Lovely. Lovely. So a massive round of applause for Luke and his dad, Gareth, doing all the setup for the lights. Come round of applause, please. They're wonderful. He's not here today. He's probably in bed. But this is Mr. Neil Williams, who was responsible for building the set in record time. He painted it, built it, and he's been absolutely brilliant. So alongside Mr. Russ Bennett, my dad, who initially did all the design, the graphic design for the set, and he's so talented, and both of them together produced a wonderful set, as you can probably see. So massive round of applause for Mr. Williams and my dad, Mr. Bennett, the darlings. Next, if we can go up here, I want to just say a massive thank you to the band. I'm going to miss a few people out for obvious reasons, but first of all, on read one, Miss Margarita Rapazira, where is she? Give a little wave. Oh, she's so shy. Look, she's actually smiling. Are you smiling underneath that mask? You she actually is. Margarita was, you were read one, but also the requirement for your part was to play the flute. And she can't play the flute, she can't play it. So she goes, it's okay, so I'll learn it. So she learned to play the flute just for this particular show. So Margarita, absolutely wonderful. Give a round of applause. Trumpet one, Mr. easy, guys. Trumpet one, Mr. Gavin Bowyer, who's one of our peripatetic teachers. He comes in every Thursday to do lessons with or private lessons with the students. They absolutely adore him. He's a brilliant guy, very talented. And thank you for giving up your time for this show. So, Gavin, marvellous. Yeah, whatever, bothered. Yeah, lovely. A round of applause for Gavin. He's wonderful. Thank you very much. Trumpet two was by the wonderful Will Thomas. He's a science teacher at Samuel Ward. He's absolutely wonderful. Again, not only teaching full-time all day, but has the time to dedicate to our cast and our shows. Honestly, Will, thank you. Give him a massive round of applause. Lovely. The electric strings, Mr. Carl Younger and Mike McGivney. Where are they? They're our guitarist. Carl's our guitarist and Mike is our bassist. I've known these guys for many, many years. We played in ensembles together before, and I'm just so pleased that you have managed to come back and help me out and help out our lovely students. And I think this is like your only gig for this year, isn't it, or something? Yeah. Should I have mentioned that? Yeah, you're lovely. But no, sorry to rub it in. But thank you very much, you two, my lovely friends, Carl and Michael. Give them a round of applause, please. And this is lovely. Drums. Where's the drums? Are they underneath the... oh, they're there. Oh, my goodness, they're there. Right. Lovely Mr. Will Rogers, who came and played for us for Les Miserables. Your drumming is exceptional. I mean, I don't know how your brain works. I don't know how you even like, you know, the bongos, but that is just wonderful. You're so talented. And thank you very much, Will, for coming again to support us. Give a round of applause for Will Rogers. And finally, Billy Farr. And Billy Farr, is Ben there as well? There, oh, it's so nice to have the family there. Billy and Ben, I think I said the flowerpot men. Billy and Ben, who have been totally wonderful. And Billy, I love it when you come and play for us. And it's such a pleasure to have you here as well. And also accompanied by your amazing son. Did you share the percussion, didn't you? The percussion part. Absolutely wonderful. Give the whole band a massive round of applause. Right, I'm going to nip next door, so you guys stay where you are. Do I have to take something with me for this, or am I going to go, I'm on the floor. Okay, am I taking, is this what I'm taking? No. Sorry, what am I taking? This here. Ooh. Right, okay, here we go. Jerry McCall moment. Come on, Mr. Mayor, come with me. Come on. Come on, Monsieur Le Maire. Right. This is backstage, gents and ladies. We're going to now go backstage to meet your lovely children who are in the chorus here. And if we come this way, do you want to go through? I think this is caught on the wire. Oh, no, it's caught. Steve, can I go into the drama too with this microphone? Yeah. Oh, lovely, lovely. Okay, come with me. Here we are. This is backstage, and your lovely children have been waiting patiently in the wings to wave to you. Give a wave to your parents, please. They've been absolutely, absolutely wonderful, and they've had to wait quite a long time for some of their parts to come on, but they've been so disciplined. They've been sitting there waiting patiently and all in their seating plan. That's labelled very, very clearly. Have you enjoyed it, guys?
Yes.
That was really enthusiastic. Cheers. Should we do that one again? Have you enjoyed it, everybody?
Yeah,
boy, well done. Now, could you give a nice final wave to your parents? I know they're absolutely, totally proud of you. And I'm proud of you as well. Give yourselves a round of applause. Yay. Right. Come on, Mr. Mayor. Come on. Come on. Here he comes. Right, we're going to go back into the studio now. This is so much fun. Right, here we go. Do I need this one anymore? Not yet. Right, now, I'll just put this one down here just for a second, if that's okay. I want to also say now thank you to those people that I've left. Where have they gone? Radford, Ryan, Bush and Mottishead, you stand up, please. Wonderful. You thought I'd left you out, didn't you? You thought I left you out. I have. Right, moving on. So, no, I haven't. So, I want to say a massive thank you to my colleagues and my friends. These guys are just utterly, utterly exceptional. I cannot speak highly enough of them. And I want to introduce them to you now. This is Miss Ryan, the shortest one. Do you want a box, Miss? Are you okay? How frightfully witty. Miss Ryan joined us last September as our new music teacher, and she's incredibly talented. She's a brilliant pianist, she's a wonderful singer, and the kids absolutely adore her. And if you were to meet her, you would understand why. She's got a lovely personality, lovely charisma, and I'm just so happy you came and you moved down from Manchester and came to join us in Suffolk. I can't speak highly of you, so more highly of you. A round of applause for Miss Ryan, please. It's wonderful. And then my dearest friend, who I have to call my friend, but I'm only pretending, Miss Bush, lovely Miss Bush, who's a head of Year 11, a fantastic cellist, and also teaching part-time drama. Again, she's inundated with lots of work, but she still has time to come and dedicate most of her time, actually, to performing arts. And you're such an asset to the school and to the performing arts department. And genuinely, I don't know what I would do without you sometimes. So, Miss Bush. And by the way, that's your nice comment for the year. After that, I'm going to massively slag you off. So, just enjoy the moment, yes? Round of applause for Miss Bush. Wonderful. And I'll leave these two gents till last, because the amount of work that goes into musically directing something like this is just incredible. Mr. Radford always musically directs our shows, and he's a very talented musician, and he's got a beautiful perm as well. And I think he permed it up for tonight. It's got lots of volume, sir. That's lovely. Sorry, shall I move on, shall I? But this year, Mr. Radford has been accompanied by Thomas Mottishead, who is our new Cambridge graduate music trainee, who joined us in, was it September, wasn't it, sir? And we thought it'd be a good idea just to offload a lot of the work onto you so we can just sit back and chill for a little bit. And these two together have worked tirelessly. Tom's been teaching a lot of the numbers to the students, and Thomas stepped in, about a month ago, and started to get used to the score. And you've been brilliant. I don't know how you've managed it. He's kept the band and the cast in control throughout the entire week. So, Mr. Mottishead, Mr. Radford, my sincere thanks. Thank you very much. Now you can sit down. Last but not least, your students, your children. Oh my goodness me. I don't know what's happened here, but I think we've literally got the finest students in not only the county, but probably the country. I'm going to introduce you to them. My four Skid Row girls, there's three. What's going on? Where's the fourth one? Oh, yeah. Nicely in place. Chris, well done. We've got Angela, Maya, Kezia, who's also the president of the school. Mr. President, hello. And we've got Gracie as well. They've been our four Skid Row girls. Miss Ryan has been watching over them, teaching the harmonies for the last, what was it, year now, isn't it, really? And they've been wonderful. Round of applause for these guys as well. We've got fantastic Aidan Elsden. Aidan Elsden stepped into the role. It wasn't originally you playing it. It was Felix Gunstone. But unfortunately, Felix left and went to, was it Cambridge? Yeah, Cambridge for his post-16 education. Aidan took over the role. Learned it in, what was it? Got 3 or 4 weeks? Something like that. And you can probably agree what a job he did of that in such a short space of time. So, Aidan, good lad, what a legend you are. Give him a round of applause. same thing. Same thing goes to Makuka Jumar. No, Makuka wasn't the original Mushnik either. It was Brandon Hattam, who again left to do post-16 education at Cambridge. And he had to you haven't done a show before, have you?
No.
This was his first show, his first performance since being at school. First performance ever. Again, I think you learnt it in a little bit shorter time, probably about 3 weeks, wasn't it? Oh my God, I don't know how he did that, but what a fantastic young man you are. So, a massive round of applause for Makuka. What a brilliant guy. Then we're going to go over here, going to say a huge thank you. TJ's no stranger to the stage, and what a voice you've got, TJ. I really hope that you decide to stay on post-16 education here at Samuel Ward and not go anywhere else, because we need people like you, because you are wonderful. Don't say you are going. You're staying. Good lad. Well done. Drama, A-level. Good man. TJ was off stage for most of it and played Audrey 2, the plant. He was the voice for the plant, and what a brilliant job you did, TJ. A massive round of applause for him. Thank you very much. And second to last, Mr. Benjamin Freer. Now, I've known Ben since year 7. I met Ben at summer school about 6 years ago, and you were like about, 1'3" tall. he came on and showed me some skills in the guitar, and it was just absolutely amazing. And I've seen you get better and better and better and better in your education here, and he's also incredibly modest, which is just the epitome of what we want here for performing arts. You are brilliant, Ben, and keep being modest and keep being amazing, and thank you for everything you've done for us. Massive round of applause to Ben Freer. So that's it. God, I'm just kidding. So now I want to say another thank you. Can you stand up, please, Izzy? Do you mind? Are you comfortable?
Yeah.
What do you mean, ooh? What are you talking about, ooh? Right. This is Izzy Wilson, right? No one likes her, including me. However, we couldn't stop her coming back. We had to do a lot of recasting for this show, and Audrey was one of the parts we were thinking, me, Mr. Radford, Miss Ryan, and Miss Bush, what are we going to do? We cannot recast this, because Izzy is 18 and has gone off to university to study at Colchester. You're doing performing arts, aren't you, at the Colchester Institute, is that correct? And we thought, she ain't coming back. And then I thought, sending out a little email, just to ask if she wouldn't mind, and she said yes, and her college allowed her time off her university studies to come back to Haverhill and rehearse with us. And when you came back a couple of weeks ago to rehearse, she still knew all of the lines, all of the harmonies, all of the songs, all of the blocking. And I cannot. This is one of the reasons why these students here absolutely baffle me, because you are so talented, and you are so so nice as well. And your mum and dad, who's hopefully watching. Legends, will surely be proud of you as well, because I'm incredibly proud of you. And this is Izzy's genuine last show with us. It is sad, but what a 7 years you've had with us. So Izzy, I'm sure I want to extend my thanks from the cast and the crew, but just thank you for all of your time for the last 7 years. We will all miss you very much. So thank you for being amazing.
Thank
Izzy
you.
Wilson. So that's it. I want to say, just remind everybody about staying safe and for the next few weeks. And I think it was quite nice we managed to do something like this in such difficult circumstances. And we're very, very proud of the school, the Performing Arts Department. And I want to thank now all the parents, all you guys for logging on, for donating, which of course you didn't have to, but it shows how wonderful you are and how supportive you are of the department and your kids. And yeah, I'll forever be grateful to all of you. So could you please give your parents a huge round of applause, please? So, let's go, Mr. Mayor. Let's go, Mr. Mayor. Oh, you're right. We're just going to play you a little song so you can see how the band works up here. Here they are. This is the band. Give a little wave, guys. Very much in unison. How good was that? That's lovely. Which one are we playing, Mr. Martin's Head?
Number one, why not?
Excellent stuff. Right.
Yeah,